Thanks for joining us for Celebration of Worship. First United Methodist Church is a welcoming community of faith that strives to be a place where everyone can belong, believe, and become a blessing. At First United Methodist Church, you can come just as you are to grow in your desire to know Christ, as well as discover your own unique way of making the world a better place at 201 Monroe Street in Jefferson City. We hope you enjoy today's message.
Good morning. It is wonderful to have you here today. We're really grateful for your presence. My name's Daniel Hilty. I'm one of the pastors here. I want to say a special word of welcome to those of you who are guests with us today. Maybe it's your first or second or third time or fourth, but whatever brings you here today, if you haven't been here a lot, we are so grateful to God that you have chosen to include a part of your Sunday morning here and part of your worship of God here. We hope that you have a sense of just how much God loves you this hour. And Jesus loves you. And we hope that you'll be back. We want you to know you're always welcome here. Good morning as well, or good evening, whenever you're watching, to those of you tuning in on TV and on the internet. We are grateful for your participation in that way as well. And we pray God's blessings on you. Keith mentioned a moment ago, we are kicking off a new series today. But before we get into that, I'd like to ask you to please pray with me. Let's pray. Come, O Holy Spirit, and dwell with us. Shape us and form us and make us more after your image, the image of Jesus Christ in the world, for your purposes, for your work, for your love. O God, you are our joy, our celebration. In days of gladness, you are our comfort and our hope and our solace. In days of grief or worry, whatever kind of day we may be having today, O Lord, we lift it to you. We pray that you would receive the contents of our hearts and our minds as our offering to you. Be pleased in this offering, we pray, O God. Be pleased in all that we speak and sing and think and feel and share and do this hour. May it be about you and serve to draw us closer to you and to our neighbors. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So today we are starting a new four-week series titled The Biology of Faith. And this first week today, it's really kind of an introduction to the overall theme, to the overall idea behind the series. And the idea behind the series is to try to take a look at the connection between God and Christian discipleship and our brains, right? How our brains work, how our brains are put together. Because, you know, our brains are these really powerful, complicated instruments from God, right? On the one hand, our brains help us to experience God, to draw closer to God, to draw closer to each other, to bring healing to the world. On the other hand, at times, our brains can also serve to draw us away from God, to draw us away from our neighbors, to bring hurt or suffering to the world. In other words, our brains can be home to a lot of contradictions, right? Our brains can be home to a lot of contradictions. For example, consider the curious case of Deacon Brodie. Anybody ever heard of the name Deacon Brodie before? Deacon Brodie's story is really, really fascinating. Deacon Brodie was one of the most respected citizens of Edinburgh, Scotland during the 1700s. Just picture a very, you know, upstanding, righteous, right kind of person, right, in the 1700s in Edinburgh, Scotland. That was Deacon Brody. Deacon Brody was a member of the city council. He was the leader of a guild there in Edinburgh, and he was also the best locksmith in the entire city. Deacon Brody made the best locks. Right? He made the best locks. And so whenever a bank there in Edinburgh needed to secure their vaults, Deacon Brody was their guy. Whenever the most well-to-do citizens of Edinburgh wanted to secure their wealth away from the rest of the world, they would give Deacon Brody a call. Or they would knock on his door, or whatever they did back in the 1700s to contact people. But Deacon Brody also held a secret. He was a man of great contradictions, but nobody really knew it. I mean, think about it like this. If you are the one person in a city, if you are the one person in a city who has built all of the locks to lock away all of the wealth and all of the treasure and keep it all secure, what does that also mean about you? Yeah, you're also the one person who knows how to unlock all of that, right? You're also the one person who knows how to get into all of that wealth and all of that riches. And so at night, Deacon Brody was a burglar, right? He was a burglar, he was. He used his knowledge of all of these locks that he had made to open up and break all of these locks that he had made, right? And he would go around and break into places at night and steal things at night. And he lived this kind of double life for 20 years, right? For 20 years, they never figured out who was doing this. For 20 years until he was found out, Deacon Brody was a well-respected, upstanding member of the community by day and a notorious criminal by night. Deacon Brody's mind contained these two competing motivations, and they were at odds with each other, right? His mind, his brain contained these moral contradictions. But his story doesn't end there. About 100 years after Deacon Brody died, another citizen of Edinburgh, Scotland, the same city, was so intrigued by Deacon Brody's story that he was inspired to write a book, a fictional book inspired by the story of Deacon Brody. It was a story which used fiction to explore the capacity of one person's brain to contain such a strong moral contradiction. The author of this book was a very famous Scottish author named Robert Louis Stevenson, and the name of the book was, any guesses? That's exactly right. Good job. Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, right? Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, as some of you may know, is a story about a respectable, upstanding citizen, right? A scientist in this case, named Dr. Jekyll, just like Deacon Brody, right? And Dr. Jekyll created this secret potion that he drank, which would transform him into the evil, malevolent villain, Mr. Hyde, right? Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde were the personifications of this moral contradiction in the brain that we saw in Deacon Brody. So the real-life Deacon Brody inspired the classical fiction story of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. And Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, in turn, inspired another classic story, the old Nutty Professor movie, right? Starring Jerry Lewis, right, and Stella Stevens, which came out in 1963. I love his look there. This is one of my mom's favorite films, by the way, the Nutty Professor. And then the 1963 Nutty Professor movie inspired another classic tale, which came out about 30 years later, Eddie Murphy's The Nutty Professor, right, which came out in 1996. But all of them, all of these stories, all of these movies trace their roots back to the story of Deacon Brody, right? The locksmith of Edinburgh, who showed just how strong the contradictions of the mind, the contradictions of the brain can be. And yet, you know, we human beings, we've been dealing with contradictions of the mind, contradictions of the brain, long before Deacon Brody, right? I mean, for example, let's take a look at our scripture reading today. Our scripture reading today is Romans chapter 7. And in Romans chapter 7, we find the Apostle Paul writing about his own contradictions of the brain that he's facing, that he's dealing with. This is what Paul says in Romans 7. He says, "What I don't understand about myself is that I decide one way, but then I act another, doing things I absolutely despise. I decide one way, but act another," Paul says. I mean, kind of like, you know, Jekyll and Hyde, right? Or Deacon Brody. Paul goes on. "So, if I can't be trusted to figure out what is best for myself and then do it, it becomes obvious that God's command is necessary. But I need something more," Paul says. "I need something more." In other words, just this external list of rules outside of himself isn't enough. "For if I know the law but still can't keep it," Paul says, "and if the power of sin within me keeps sabotaging my best intentions, I obviously need help. I realize that I don't have what it takes," Paul says. "I can will it, but I can't do it." And then here's really the heart of the scripture, I believe. "I decide to do good, but I don't really do it. I decide not to do bad, but then I do it anyway." And then he goes on to say, "It happens so regularly that it's predictable. The moment I decide to do good, sin is there to trip me up. I truly delight in God's commands, but it's pretty obvious that not all of me joins in that delight. Parts of me covertly rebel, and just when I least expect it, they take charge. I have tried everything," Paul says, "and nothing helps. I'm at the end of my rope. Is there no one who can do anything for me? Isn't that the real question?" I love this passage. It's so honest, right? It's so real. I know I can relate to it a lot. Maybe you feel that way too. I mean, this passage, Paul is kind of like Deacon Brody and Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde and the Nutty Professor, both the Eddie Murphy version and the Jerry Lewis version, all wrapped up into one, right? There are all these moral contradictions in his mind and heart. Parts of him wants to do the right thing, but other parts of him choose to do the wrong thing. "I decide to do good, but I don't really do it. I decide not to do bad, but then I do it anyway." I wonder which creates more hurt in the world, more suffering in the world, the bad that we do even though we say we're not going to, or the good that we don't do even though we say we're going to. I don't know. But have you ever experienced something like that? Have you ever felt contradictions in your heart and your mind like that? I have, right? I have. I feel that way a lot. And you know, sometimes it can be funny. Sometimes it can even be funny because it's so ridiculous. For example, a favorite Seinfeld skit that Kristen and I relate to really well, came from years ago, is his morning guy versus night guy skit. Do you know this one? Have you guys heard of this one before? It's one of our favorites because At least I could relate to it really well. Seinfeld says that there are two people inside of him, right? Just like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, right? Two people inside of him. There's morning guy and there's night guy. And morning guy and night guy, they hate each other, right? They're always trying to undo each other. And so every night when it's time to go to bed, night guy is like, go ahead and stay up, right? Go ahead and stay up. Morning guy won't mind. So what if you only get 5 hours of sleep? That's morning guy's problem. Don't worry about it, right? I'm night guy. Let's just stay up and have fun, right? But then if you do stay up and you get a short night's sleep, when you have to wake up the next morning, morning guy is furious, right? He's like, oh, that night guy, I hate him so much, right? Why does he do this to me? Night guy and morning guy are a contradiction of the mind that I can relate to really well. Or a slightly more serious example. Recently, I'd say maybe about 6 months ago or so, I decided that I was going to try to stop giving my son and daughter so much unsolicited advice, right? And if you're a parent, I can tell by your laughter that you know that's not always not the easiest thing to do, right? Because, you know, our kids, our son and our daughter, they're both these wonderful young adults now, right? One of them's in high school, one of them's in middle school. They're both already a lot smarter than I will ever be. And even though there will always be a role for a parent to play in a child's life, no matter the age, I also know how it feels to be around someone who's always giving you unsolicited advice. I mean, how does that feel? It feels awful, right? It feels awful to be around somebody who's always feeling like it's their obligation to tell you what to do, right? What they would do in your case. And so, a while ago, I decided I was going to try my very best to respect my kids more by giving unsolicited advice less. And that's one thing I have asked God to help me with every morning in my prayers. Oh God, please help me today to give unsolicited advice less to my kids, just to respect them for the people that God made them to be. And you know what? Almost every day I mess it up, right? Almost every day I mess it up before I even realize that I'm doing it, right? Before I even realize what I'm doing it, I'm telling my son or my daughter, well, you know, here's what you should do, right? Or, well, here's your problem, right? And as soon as it comes out of my mouth, I realize what I'm doing, but I can't take it back. Yeah. I decide to do good, but I don't really do it. I decide not to do bad, but then I do it anyway. That's me. And I suspect that if I surveyed all of us here today, there's a good chance we would say that it is each of the rest of us, too, in one way or another. From the Apostle Paul to Deacon Brody to you and me, we human beings have always known what it feels like spiritually, to experience contradictions of the mind. But it's just been in the last 50 years or so that scientists have also started to discover that there are physical, neurological reasons for why we feel that way too. That it doesn't just have a spiritual basis, it has a physical basis in our minds. And it has to do with different regions that are in our brains, right? And you know, needless to say, I am no brain scientist, right? And I am no brain surgeon and all of that. But I've tried to research this as best as I could leading up to this series. And as I understand it, you know, there are all these different regions in our brains, and they're all interconnected, and they all influence each other in one way or another. It's not just cut and dry. And yet they all also serve different purposes, too, in our brains, right? So that sometimes those different regions of our brain feel as if they are at odds with each other, as if they are in contradiction to each other, right? There are the amygdalae, for example. The amygdalae are what cause us to experience fear. There have been some really fascinating cases of people whose amygdalae have actually become deactivated. It's a very rare condition, so that they literally cannot experience fear. It's a very rare case. but they literally cannot experience fear because their amygdala shut down, which, as you might imagine, has some benefits and some drawbacks, right, if you can't experience fear in life. There's the limbic system, which governs a lot of our other emotions. There's the neocortex, which makes possible learning and reflection and self-awareness and compassion. Part of what we're talking about, there's also something called the parietal lobe, which can actually help to give us a sense of God. That's actually something we're going to talk a lot about next week. Next week, we're talking a lot about the parietal lobe. And then there are many other regions, right? That's the plus. Many other regions, many other purposes, with many other names. They're not even called the same name sometimes, depending on the model of the brain you're talking about. And you know, no region is inherently good or inherently bad. Again, they all serve a purpose. God made us all, right? But sometimes those purposes are at odds with each other. Sometimes they create contradictions in our brains. And so the real issue is not whether certain functions of our brains are better or worse than other functions, but which part of the brain we will allow to be in charge of the others. Right? That's the real question. Which part of the brain, which will we make the adult, and which will we make the child, the infant? It's kind of like this. One of my favorite religious writers, a gentleman named Thich Nhat Hanh, puts it like this. He says that it is as if our minds are nurseries, right? As if our minds are nurseries. Nurseries that contain babies. Babies that are crying out for attention. Here are the babies. There are the babies that you saw. And one of the babies may be named fear, and another anger, and another guilt, and another jealousy, which, by the way, I have to say, are absolutely horrible names for babies, right? So please never name your child guilt, right? Unless you want to pay for a lifetime of counseling for that child, right? But metaphorically speaking, it's as if we have these different parts of our brain that are crying out for attention. And our fear, our amygdala, right? Our fear are crying out, pay attention to us, right? Pay attention to me. I'm fear. I'm afraid. Our anger is crying out, pay attention to me, right? I'm angry. Pay attention to me. Our guilt, our jealousy, same with them, on and on. And none of them is necessarily bad, right? Just like babies aren't bad, right? Babies are wonderful. When they cry, they just want attention. But neither should the babies be trusted to make the most important decisions in life either, right? Instead, what do we do when a baby cries? Well, we pick her up, right? And we hold her, and we reassure her that she doesn't have to be afraid. Everything's going to be okay. And likewise, when we feel afraid, when our amygdala kick in, right, and say, be afraid of something, we don't have to get angry at ourselves for it. It is natural, after all. It's part of the brain God gave us. But neither do we have to let our fear make the most important decisions in life for us. And so when Paul says this, right, when Paul says that he doesn't do the good he decides to do, and that he does the bad he doesn't want, what he's really saying from the perspective of the brain, right, is that he's allowing the parts that choose selfishness to be in charge of the ones that choose unselfishness. He's allowing the parts that choose fear to be in charge of the ones that choose compassion. He's articulating in a very spiritual way this same predicament that we find ourselves in at one time or another. Thankfully, there are ways to retrain our brains, to teach our brains to choose compassion over fear, to choose unselfishness over selfishness. And what's really interesting is that a lot of those ways to retrain our brains are reflected very clearly in the teachings of Jesus. They're reflected very clearly in the teachings of Jesus. Because, as Paul says at the end of our passage today, Jesus acted to set things right in this life of contradictions. Right? Jesus offers us a way forward through all of the contradictions that we face in our lives and in our minds. And so that's the real focus of the series over the next few weeks. We'll be talking about spiritual practices, very concrete spiritual practices rooted in Jesus, which from a religious perspective reshape our hearts, but from a scientific perspective retrain our brains. And so next week, for example, we'll take a look at the practice of getting outside of ourselves, which is rooted in Jesus. The week after that, we'll talk about the practice of making one small change at a time, which again is rooted in Jesus. And then finally, week four, we'll discuss the spiritual practice of taking time to see things a little bit more clearly in life, which again is rooted in Jesus. Each of these is an ancient spiritual practice rooted in the teachings of Jesus. And yet, at the same time, they've been shown to retrain our brains. They're ancient Christian scientifically valid methods for literally changing our minds. Which is just another way of saying that these three methods for bringing about a change in our minds are really three methods for bringing about this. Conversion. Conversion in the Bible, it's one of my favorite Bible words. Conversion in the Bible is an interesting word with an interesting history. In the Bible, we're going to start at the top here. In the Bible, the word for changing our minds is metanoia, that middle word in Greek, metanoia. Only we don't usually translate metanoia as changing our minds. Instead, we usually translate it as conversion. But the literal meaning behind the word, when we say conversion, the literal meaning for that in the Bible is changing our minds. That's what conversion literally is in the Bible, changing of the mind. And that's really what we're going to be talking about over the next few weeks. It's the mechanics of conversion, right? It's the inner workings of how conversion happens in our minds. And so if you or I feel a little bit like Deacon Brody today, if you or I feel a little bit like Jekyll or Hyde or the Nutty Professor or like Paul, if we feel frustrated this morning or angry about contradictions that we see in our own lives between what we want to be and what we actually do, then I invite us to hear this good news. This is good news that is tailor-made just for us. The good news is that Jesus really has acted to set things right in this life of contradictions. You see, Jesus acted not just to save our souls, but also to change our minds, literally to change our minds. It is what conversion is all about. It may not happen overnight, but it does happen. It can happen. And the first step is simply to trust Jesus enough to show us how. Thanks be to God. Amen.